Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Heavenly Father, just on this wonderful and beautiful morning
here on your beach, Lord, we thank you to allow us to enjoy your home, to hear your message, and to basically internalize, Lord, the message you have for us today. Father, I ask that you calm everyone's heart today, that you take away all the distractions or things that we have on our mind, mm-hmm. and Lord, that you prepare Pastor Izzy to give your message as you would deem appropriate, because we know that someone in the audience today may really need to hear it, and so we'd love for it to get right to the heart of those who need it, and Lord, we just thank you for him, his family, and the word today. Mm.
For Steve and Aaron.
And then also we pray, Lord, for those victims in Orlando, Lord, as they go through this very difficult time. We just ask that you calm hearts and then raise people up there as best you can, Lord, to help those in need. Father, we love you and praise you. And on this day, we give you thanks. Amen.
Amen. Well, guys, would you turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 5? We are all the way to verse 13. We're coming on the last portion of this letter that we've been studying, and this is one of my all-time favorite verses. Actually, it's a paragraph in the Greek. It starts at verse 13 and goes to verse 15. This paragraph has carried me through so many things in my faith, and I want to share it with you, hoping that it will be able to be imparted to you, that you could, some of you already know it, so you've already been holding fast to these words, But there's a promise here that John is writing. Now remember, John's writing this book around 96 AD. So the church has been in existence for about, six decades that it's been. Remember, Jesus went to the Father at 33 AD. So here John is writing, and this letter that he writes, being that the church has been around a while, there, it's funny what can happen in 50 years to a movement of faith. You know, just think back. John was alive when Jesus was walking the earth. John walked with him. John was there with him. And John says, I touched him. I heard him. You know, he's an eyewitness to the things what Jesus taught. He was eyewitness to the miracles. Now, would anyone like to go in time travel with me if we had one of them machines? To go see Jesus, like heal the guy that was lame, that couldn't Jesus, or the guy with the withered hand. Remember at the temple, he was there, and the Pharisees, it says, put him in the front row, in the temple, just like because they were gonna test Jesus. They knew he couldn't walk past somebody hurting and leave it alone, so they put the guy with the withered hand. It says it was withered from birth. Can you imagine if your hand was withered from birth, it was all drawn up, would he have any muscle in his arms, or, you know, it'd be skin and bone. And they put that guy right in the front, and they knew, it was the Sabbath day, by the way, the Lord's day. And they knew he couldn't walk by and just, you know, Jesus, full of compassion and mercy. What's he gonna do? Heal him. So Jesus walks by the fellow. Now, I wanna go see. I mean, we have the words, but I'm a visual learner. I wanna go. You know, I'd like to sit maybe over on the side where I see right the front row. Maybe, you know, like, well, I grew up as a good Italian Roman Catholic boy. I was an altar boy. And we got to sit in the front, you know, up behind the priest. So I kind of would like to do my altar boy seating, you know, on just for the temple day. You know, the guy is right there in the front. I'm like right here. And I get to no one blocking my view. And here comes Jesus, and they invited Jesus, come on up and read from the scriptures for us, you know. Come on up, and they knew there is a plant. They put him right there so that when he walks by, he looks at the fellow. Now, I want to see, did he just walk by the fellow and just tap him on the shoulder? Hey, stretch forth thy hand and go on up and begin to read. But do you know what happened that day when he said, stretch forth your hand? The guy said, I can't do that, right? If I could stretch forth my hand, I would have stretched it forth a long time ago. What kind of teacher are you? No. Did he say that? No. The Bible says that as soon as Jesus said to do it, and by the way, this is a good lesson for us to learn as we get into this part we're going to look at first John. If Jesus says to do anything, even if it's impossible to you in your own natural abilities, I mean, this man, if he could have stretched forth his hand, I'm sure he would have done it way before this day. But when Jesus says to do something, on that day, when he says do it, remember Peter in the boat and there was a storm and Jesus is coming walking on the water and Jesus, the guys are like, oh, a ghost. And Jesus, it's not a ghost, it's me. And Peter says, if it's you, you guys know what he said, right? I love this story. Bid me to what? To come to you. Jesus is like, all right, come. Now, any of you got out of a boat and walked on water without water skis or toys or, you know? I mean, in the middle of a storm, he says, come. And though it's not in Peter's natural ability to do it, if, pay attention to this, if Jesus is telling you to do something, should you do it? Because let me tell you, if he tells you to do something, even though it's impossible to us, by the power of his command, the power that he has, you can do the impossible. That man, I want to sit front row and watch. And Jesus goes, stretch forth your hand. And he went, and his hand was made whole. Now, you know what they wanted to do? They're like, Jesus, this is the Sabbath. You're not supposed to do any work on the Sabbath. And they were mad at him. But think about, why were they really mad at him? What do you think it just did in the audience? You know, when the guy getting up to read now just happened to do a miracle on his way up. They were jealous. They were so jealous of Jesus because everywhere he went, he was touching people. He was helping people. He was healing them. He was freeing them from whatever afflictions they had. I like his style. But see, when you're a religious leader who's used to having this pseudo kind of, it's a false power, but it is a power where they like to lord over men, the Bible says. They want to rule over others. And here comes a guy who is freeing people from others, freeing them from all the problems. And John, he saw Jesus do all these things. So I saw this. He's awesome, man, what he did. Now, John is going to tell us in 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, why did he write this book? And the kids don't understand why I do this, but I had to take literary classes when I was younger, and I've shared with you before, Italian's my first language, so English is, I always wonder why God made me the speaker, because you guys could probably do better with a guy that did English first, but I had to learn that in literary class that, you know, when you read a book, any piece of literature, as you read that book, you get to gain some insight about the author of the book. And any good student of any piece of literature will usually start with a few things that will help them unlock even deeper understandings of what the author is writing. First of all, find out who the author is. I was always taught this. Find out who's writing the book. And then, secondly, we were taught, to find out who are they writing to? Who's their audience? You know, if you know who's writing, who they're writing to, it kind of sets a little bit of understanding to the, so some of the things that are written, you might not pick up on, why did they write that? But if you know who's writing, who they're writing to, don't you get a little bit more, oh yeah, now it makes sense. I mean, some stories that you've read don't make much sense till you find out it was written by a dad who was at the war trying to communicate a message to his son, but he couldn't do it because it would be, you know, put them in danger, so he had to do it incognito with little clues, you know, in this kind of fictional sounding story, but it was communicating a message. And once you know that, you go back through the story and you're like, oh, now it has some meat, you know, now I see why he was talking about the barn and out behind the barn, you know, and he was given see, but you wouldn't pick up on those things if you don't know who the author is and you don't know who he's writing to. So John has been writing to those that believe in the name of Jesus. So his audience is, who believes in Jesus here? Raise your hand. Okay, it's us. It's not just us. It was all the guys that came to faith before us and passed the faith on all the way to us. But he's writing to believers. And he was, he had spent some years by now pastoring the flock. You know, he had heard Jesus say to Peter, "Peter, do you love me?" Peter's like, "Yeah, I love you, Lord." Then do what? What did he tell Peter to do? Feed my sheep, right? And he said, "You love me?" Again, "Yes, Lord. Tend my lambs." "Peter, do you love me?" "Yeah, shepherd my sheep. Look after my sheep. Look after, take care of them." By the way, John went on to be one of these pastors that looked after the flock of God. And I see that what a maturity he has. This is a question. If you haven't been in ministry, you might not see the significance of verse 13. But if you've been in ministry, you know that over the course of ministering to many people in their journey of faith, this verse stands out as one of the highlights of all verses because it answers one of the most repeated questions we ever get asked as ministers. And you want to know what that question is? How do I know if I get eternal life? I mean, is it for real? For sure. Can we confidently know that we have everlasting life? And so John writes these things. Look at verse 13. "These things," he says, "I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you might wonder if you have everlasting life." Right? Is that what it says? I'm just seeing who's paying attention. Look down. I already know what it says. It says, "so that you may know," kenosko in the Greek, that means to know intimately. To know with a thoroughness, like you studied to get your master's degree. This is not knowledge of you just heard it once. This is so that you might wonder, because I heard you might get everlasting life, but you're not really sure. This is so you absolutely know. Now, why does he have to write to believers who believe in the name of the Son of God, right? Why does he have to write to them and say, "I wrote these things to you so that you may know that you have everlasting life"? I mean, didn't they already know that? How many people do you think don't know that? They're not sure. You ask them, if you were to die today, do you know if you would go to be with the Lord? Do you know you have everlasting life? And I can tell you, there are many folks that will answer that question, "Well, I'm not sure. I hope so. Or maybe. I hope I die on a good day. You know, after I did some good things and not some bad things." Or being raised Catholic, it was, "I hope I die," me personally, was after Saturday confession. Because that way, all my sins, right, of the week I took care of. And then, "Lord, take me on Saturday night, please, before I can rack up too much more." Because I was the oldest of 6 kids. And I don't know if you've seen Italian families interact, but by Sunday, I was sure I sinned a few times. And so I was kind of like, "Lord, after I get out of the box, could you just get me there? Just tap, take me, that I know." And I know it sounds silly, but it's because somebody didn't teach me this verse. They didn't teach. See, my understanding wasn't based on my faith in the Son of God. It was somehow based, I believed in him, yes. But I thought, I have to do some extra good stuff. And I better go out on a good note. You know, I hope that it's not after I did a lot of bad stuff and I didn't get to the confession box in time. And I don't know why I thought like that. But does anyone can relate to what I'm saying? That you thought, "Man, I hope I go on a good day." And you're just it's kind of, I don't know if it's just internally wired in us where we think that, you know, that we want to go out pleasing God on that day, and we want to be a good way out. But we do this. And John has been pastoring for a couple decades now, and he's going, "Guys, I got some news for you. I wrote this whole letter so you would know, not so you would wonder, not so that you might be, maybe, could be, would be on a good day going to get everlasting life, but so you would know that you have. Now, he doesn't say that you obtain it later, like after you die, then you start. No. Jesus said, "I came to give you life." We did this last week. Life, and to give it to you more what? Abundantly. And that I've heard preached many different ways. Some guys say he came to give us life, that is everlasting life. And then the more abundant part, they say, is that portion of life that we still have down here until we see him. And he makes that even more abundant living because we get to walk with him through the rest of this time we spend down here. I've heard it flipped the other way by preachers. By the way, in Greek, I can't prove it either way. I mean, I could teach you both. They're neither wrong. But some guys use the first, I came to give you life, and they say, that's the life we have down here, and the more abundant life is the life we get up there. And then I've heard other preachers switch them to the opposite. I don't care. They're both included. Does that make, you know, some guys like to fight over stupid stuff. Don't go there. It's not even worth it. The facts is the facts. He came to give us life. More abundant life. And you need to know that you have eternal life. Because sometimes we face trials and tribulations in this life. And one of the things we have as Christians is that thing that is the anchor of our faith. That knowledge that no matter what happens, the worst day. I mean, for us, you know, some of us, we think the worst day would be the day we die. Which, as a Christian, is actually not the worst day. Maybe our way out might not be good, but hey, face it, once we're done, we're out of here, right? And that's our best day, because that's our first day in heaven. The Bible says, when you are absent from the body, what's it say in Corinthians? As soon as you're absent from this body, you're present where? With the Lord. So it's not really our worst day. It's kind of like the best. Yeah. Well, we're done, man. We're gonna be all right. But to get through these days down here, let me tell you, as a pastor, this is something we have to like be like a broken record. We gotta, you know, revisit this all the time for different people at different parts in their journey of faith. They struggle and they wonder, I wonder if I'm really going to be in the club. I wonder if God will accept me. I wonder if I'm really going to be in heaven with him. And John writes, I wrote you this whole book, not so that you would wonder, not so that you might, maybe, could be, would be, hopefully on a good day get to heaven. No, I'm telling you so you know. Use your mind. Don't check your mind. Don't shut it off right now. You need to use this gray matter because this is the part of your being God gave you to know. It says, love the Lord with all your heart. What's the next part? All your mind, all your soul, and all your strength. Don't shut off your mind. You need your mind for this morning because this word gnosko is the mind knowing, having this knowledge that you've studied, you've mastered this. How many of you mastered the idea you have everlasting life if you believe in Jesus? You got that mastered? If someone came to you and said, are you sure? You could tell them, absolutely. How do you know? Right here, 1 John 5:13. Says it right in the Bible, right there. From the eyewitness guy who was the guy that was leaning, remember, on Jesus at the Last Supper. When you talk about, you want credible witnesses who were there. We're not talking about some guy that was in the balcony seating looking down. He was the guy that said, I was there. This is how close I was. Here's Jesus. Here's me. Hey, Lord, good to have supper with you. Anyone would like to be that close to the Lord? I mean, seriously, if I could switch with anybody, for that moment, that would be good. Later, they're going to put John in a boiling pot of oil to kill him, and it won't kill him. So they'll banish him to the island of Patmos, where he'll write the book of Revelation that we're studying with the college and career group on Saturday night. But I would trade him for the day on the Last Supper, at least for supper. Later, you remember, they're going to be following the Lord at a distance, and they're going to go to Peter. Hey, you're one of his followers. And remember, Jesus told them at the supper, Peter, before the cock crows twice, you're going to deny me three times that you know me. Not me, Lord. I'll go with you to death, good old Peter. Wet socks Peter, I call him. Open mouth, insert foot, right? He thinks he... How many times do we think we know better than Jesus? Not me, Lord. I got this covered. The Lord's going, nope. I know you'll fail. Now, did Jesus' love for Peter stop because he knew he was going to fail? Did he say, that's it, you're out of the club? No, Jesus said, when you have once returned, Jesus even knew he would return to his faith. He said, when you have returned, strengthen the brethren. He was speaking right to him. You're going to fail me, but you're going to return, so just keep on with what I called you to do. Take care of my sheep. Now, John witnessed all those things. And he witnessed, I believe, a lot of believers going through the same problem that we have today. People not assured of this truth, that they have everlasting life. They don't know for certain. They hope. They wish. They hopefully wish they could be, would be. But I'm not here to preach that to you. I'm here to tell you, if you believe in the name of the Son of God, Jesus. Let me see those hands again. This is the funnest part. Look at that. All right. Guess what, guys? I can finish the sermon right now. You all have eternal life. Hold on to it. Don't be like, oh, I don't know. You have it. Now, the next two verses give me the greatest of confidence in my faith. And they get me through some of the hardest of times. But you got to pay attention to some of the little subtle details in these words. Let me read it to you. Verse 14 says this. This is the confidence which we have before him. If we ask anything according to his will, he what? He hears us. And what's the next verse say, verse 15? And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests which we have asked from him. Anybody want to get your prayers answered? You know, like 100% guarantee. This is one of the things when I was teaching the youth. I said, I'm going to teach you guys the secret how to get your prayers answered 100% guaranteed. They're like, all ears, man. This works every time. Well, really? Yeah, 100%. And I'm not the one guaranteeing. I'm going to use the Bible, a verse right here, to guarantee your answer. They're like, okay, what is it? I said, now, you got to understand, this is how you do it. I don't know if you notice this, but there's a condition to getting 100% guaranteed answers. Did you see the condition here in verse 14? Look at that. He says, this is the confidence we have before him that if, whenever there's an if, you guys know that means there's a, like, condition. I learned that at least in English class. That if we ask anything according to whose will? His will, right? Remember when they said, teach us to pray? There in Matthew 6, and he said, pray then in this manner, our Father, which you guys know the prayer, right? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, and thy what? Will. Thy will be, whose will are you praying for in this prayer? God's will to be done where? On earth? Do you think God has a problem with answering your prayer when you're praying, God, your will be done? No. In fact, it's a condition. If you ask anything according to his will, it says, then you know he hears you. And if you know that he hears you, verse 15 says, in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests which we have asked from him. I read this verse as a young man in Bible school back in 1979 up in the San Bernardino Mountains. Calvary Chapel had this Bible school in Twin Peaks. And when I read this, there was a lot of people, you know, had heavy, we were getting news from, we were up in the mountains. Have any of you been up there at Big Bear up in San Bernardino? It's cool, it's nice, and like down in San Bernardino can be like muggy and hot and disgusting, and you get up in the mountains, you're like, oh, it's like a retreat. You know, but when you get up there in that retreat setting, it's kind of like you're away from the rest of the world, away from all the problems, and stuff is good, you know? It's like, let's see God. It's like mountaintop experience, you know? You feel close to him, and there's no troubles up here. And we would get letters, and someone would call to the school and say, hey, there was a terrible thing down here in the valley, and we need you guys to pray for this. And we get heavy news, you know. Auntie has got cancer in there, and can you guys pray? And we're up there just having a good old time, learning about God, reading the Bible all day, going to class, studying different books of the Bible. It's like, after a while, you just kind of like, I don't know, you get enough Bible, it kind of lifts your soul, you know, like floating, you know, not really, but I mean, in the spirit side of things, you just feel lifted. So we're just like kind of going, this is great. And then you get news that, oh, heavy stuff. Need prayer. You guys pray. You're up there seeking God all day. You can pray for us, right? And we're like, sure. And I read this verse. If I ask anything according to his will, then I know he hears them. And if he hears it, I know I have the thing which I asked. So, doesn't seem too difficult to me. Whatever I got to pray for, I'm just going to say, God, I ask your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, you guys are going to laugh, but this is like a big revelation for me, okay? This is like new way to pray. Whenever I pray, I'm just going to go, God, we got some problems down here. Here's the problem. I lay it at your feet. And not like you don't know about it. You know, sometimes we think we're informing him. God, you probably didn't know that Sister Sally has a big tumor and she needs a touch. And he already knows. You're not like really have to inform. Some guys at men's prayer, they're like, as they pray, they're like giving God the full description. Now, I don't know if they're doing that for God's sake or everyone else in the room, but I don't think he really needs to know because he already does. So when we pray, we just go to him. Say, Lord, here's our petition. Could you help Sister Sally? She needs your touch. And we ask it. We want you to hear our prayer. And if you want him to hear your prayer, what do you have to pray? According to whose will? Your will? No, his will. Now, this is hard for us as humans sometimes to submit to the idea that, how many think God's will is better than our will? Because, you know, sometimes we're pretty sure our will is good. You know, like, and some come to me, Pastor, I am sure my will is the best, and who cares what God's will is? This is what I want. So you tell him, I want this person to be my spouse, and I want that car, and I want that house, and they're informing me. Whose will are they praying for? Theirs. Yeah, let me show you a verse in James real quick. It's only a couple pages back from 1 John, but it's found in chapter 4 of James. In verse 3, it says, you ask, and you do not receive, James says, because you ask with wrong motives, so that you might spend it on your pleasures. You know, oftentimes people are praying, and they're not getting answers. I don't understand why you get answers, Pastor, and I don't get answers. I'm like, what are you praying about? Well, I want to win the lottery so I can have a, you know, mansion and a gazillion dollars and I can just, you know, buy my own island and kick everyone else off and have some space. And whose motives and pleasures are they thinking of? Themselves. And you know, Jesus said, he didn't come to serve himself. He says, I came to serve others. You want to be great in my kingdom, he says? Learn to be the servant of who? All. Learn to be the servant of all. I mean, we're supposed to be taking care of others. You want to muck up your prayers? Make yourself the central focus. No, not, it's not that you can't pray about things that you need. It's that you need to learn to pray, God, here's my petition about what I see. Here's what I need. And you're going to crack up, but I have found out that I really don't know stuff as best as I could. Like, he knows better than I could be going, God, we need these groceries. So I pray you give me some money so I can go buy the groceries. Now, God knows how I am in a grocery store. Ask my wife. I am not the grocery shopper. I'm the give me the list. I'll go in, get the stuff. I don't comparatively shop. I just find the stuff, put it in the basket, go to the front, and get out. And if it's Costco, I go an hour and a half early because I already know that I'm going to get stopped at the door. I got a hug at the door this week right when I got there. One of the brothers that used to work over at the recycle place by the dump, he's now been promoted and got the job at the front door. So I get a big hug. Thank you, Pastor, for praying for me. And my wife's like, who's that guy? Well, that's the guy that gives us the stuff that, you know, and then we go a couple more steps and someone else, and I rate my Costco experience by how many hugs I get. If I come out with a less than 10, I'm like, that was a bad day at Costco, you know? I got everything on the list, but no hugs. I mean, it's a small town here. For those that don't know, this is, you know, Costco is our alternative fellowship hall, right? That's where to see other Christians? Go to Costco. And you want to see a lot of them? Go after church today. Because some of them come from down south or the other side of the island. They got their coolers in their car. And as soon as they're done here, they're going to run over there, fill them up, and then head home. And, you know, get a little stuff from the food court. That's kind of the alternative fellowship eating place. Cheap. And so we go in, we do that, and then we think, okay, but when I'm praying, God, here's my need. I need some groceries. So give me some money. And this is my understanding creeping into this whole prayer. Let me show you the problem with this. I could be going, God, here's my need. I put my petition before you. I need give us this day our daily what? Bread. Here's some need for daily bread. God, I just put that before you. And then I give him instructions. Like he doesn't know what he's doing. He needs help, right? Lord, if you could just make somebody go put a little extra into the tie box or I get creative. You could have them put it in the mailbox, or you could just have the 100 fall on the ground as I'm walking and there it is by the car tire or, you know, my door, or, you know, like I have to help him out. And in all my understanding, I've come up with a great number of ways that you could get me the money, Lord. And what I've forgotten in my silliness is, and sometimes, you know, the Bible says my ways are, well, below his ways. My thoughts, what's it say? His thoughts are above my thoughts. I forget the part, like, you know, he might be going, you know, you got a full schedule today, and you really don't have time for 2.5 hours at Costco. So instead, I know you didn't think of this, but I got this covered. I got some tourists visiting, and they went to Costco when they got here. And they've been here a month, but they went and they bought all the stuff because it was cheaper to buy in bulk. And now they're leaving. And I've shared this before because this I finally realized I wasn't factoring in, but God already had covered. Lord, I need the groceries. I got the list on we put a list on our refrigerator. I don't know if any of you do this, but as we think of things, we write down, you know, get the toilet paper, getting low on toilet paper, you know, the different stuff. And we have a whole list. One day I was like, Lord, here's my daily needs. Here's the list. Give me some money to take care of the list. Someone comes to the door. Knock, knock. Excuse me, we're heading to the airport. We didn't want to throw this stuff away. Would you mind, could we give it to you? And if you could use it, use it. If you don't need it, just pass it out at church, you know, whatever. Give it to the homeless or... Okay. And I'm carrying in these boxes. It's all the Costco boxes. You guys know what they are, right? The empty stuff that they put it in. And I carry in, I'm looking down, and there's toilet paper. And there's the laundry soap. And there's the... And I get up to the kitchen table, and one at a time as I unload the box, guess what? And God was just fooling with me because he made everything I pulled out come out in the order of... And I have photographic memory. So I'm not looking at the list. I'm just unloading the box, and I'm thinking, that was on our list. Check one. That was on our list, too. Check two. That was on our... And by the time I unload all the stuff that people have brought us, everything is done. But you know what else was in the box? Something I wasn't praying for. Something I've shared this before that Raquel was praying for. You heard it, right? Chocolate mint and chip ice cream. Dad, would you get me mint and chip? No, honey, it's like $8 for a little teeny tub, you know. It's not even a half gallon anymore. They cheat you. They shrunk. Did you guys notice that? The sides of the thing tapered in now, and you look at I'm like, I ain't paying $8 or $9 for not even half a gallon, you know. It irks me. Besides that, you know, we need the money. And what's in the last thing? Mint. Sorry, we took a scoop. I come from a big family. I don't care if you took 10 scoops. you know, it didn't bother me none. I'm like, it's okay. We can handle, you know. And Raquel's like, God, you love me. You love me. Thank you, God. You know, because, see, while we're praying for the things what we understand, we're not including others. And we're not thinking that the guy who we're praying to has an infinite multiple ways that he can answer your prayer, and he could come through in ways you're not even thinking of. Maybe that guy with the withered hand was thinking, God, I just pray you could give me strength with my other hand to do the work so I could get through this day. Not even thinking that that would be the day he would have an encounter with Jesus. How do you think his day went the rest of that day? By the way, you know what they did to Jesus? They said, get out of here. This is the Sabbath. You're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. I want to know, how much work was it for Jesus? To the guy. Let's see. He said, stretch forth your hand. That was rough. That's in English. He did it in Hebrew. It's only two words. To the guy. Stretch forth your hand. Go ahead. Now, how was that guy's day from then on? How was his life touched by that one encounter with Jesus? I mean, he might have gone to temple that day, be going, God, just please give me strength so I can make it, and I'm hurting, and God's going, I got you covered. See, I like serving the Lord because his ways are, it says, way above our ways. His thoughts above our thoughts. He knows what he's doing. But sometimes we struggle with this idea. God, I'm going to pray according to your will. Lord, would you do your will? Now, as a young Christian, when I read this, I thought, well, I'd give it a shot. I mean, what's it going to hurt if I pray, okay, God, do your will? Let's see. So I began to pray, God, do your will. God, do, and there was a sister, Sheila, at Bible school with me, and we said, let's not pray anymore our will. Let's just try this. Because it also says if two or more agree on any one thing, asking in whose name? Jesus' name. Jesus said, ask in my name. Try this. That your joy would be what? Full. Just ask in my name. See what I'll do. He said, up till now, you've never asked in my name. Remember, this is all new to them. He says, ask in my name of the Father. See what I'll do. So I thought, hey, Sheila, let's just pray. God, do your will. According, and we ask in Jesus' name. You always wonder why we pray in Jesus' name at the end. That's why, because Jesus said to. In Jesus' name we ask, amen. Well, we'd pray. Phone would ring. Someone would say, you're not going to believe this. There was a miracle. You know, they called and said, pray for the auntie with the thing and the tumor. It's gone. We're like, oh, cool, that worked. Next prayer request. And we started praying, and it got, word got around at the Bible school. If you need your prayer answered, go ask Izzy and Sheila. They'll pray. They got some kind of special connection. I'm not kidding you. We were like inundated with prayer requests. And the funny part was God was really strengthening our faith because we were young. We didn't know what we're doing. We're just like, okay, God, we're new at this. Your will be done in Jesus' name. Here's our petition. Amen. And we just kept going. And every time we prayed, I'm you know how sometimes the Lord shows off just to kind of help boost your faith? He was showing off galore. I mean, every time we finish praying and all of a sudden we get a call, prayer answered. And I was like, this works really good. You know, someone should write a book, but I'm not a book writer. I'll just teach you. Here's the secret how to get your prayer answered, 100% guaranteed. Don't pray your will. Don't pray for your pleasures. Pray for others, right? Pray whose will be done? His will. Then you know he hears you. And then step back. Because it's fun to see what God can do when you ask him to do his stuff. Just let him do it. And you just, man, can he pull off stuff. It is so sweet. It kept going and going like this all through Bible school. We had so much fun. We're like, man, this is powerful. This works every time. And then this fella comes to me. I shared this at the college and career group. One of the fellows comes and says, "Hey, Iz, I need you to pray." And he pointed over to one of the sisters at the Bible school across the, we were in the activity area, and he points over to this gal and he says, "See her? I want you to pray that she'll be my wife. Because I know every time you and Sheila pray, you guys get answers. So just pray, she'll be my wife." And when he said it, right when he said it, has anyone ever had someone say something to you and you get this kind of like red alert, or some people call it a check? You get this like something that's not right. I mean, you somehow inside you know. You don't even know how you know. You're just like, that's not right. And so I looked at him. I thought, I don't feel right about this. You know, it says, ask according to whose will? God's will. So I said to him, I said, "You want me to pray because you know I get 100% answers, right? Guaranteed." He's like, "Yeah." I said, "Do you know how come I get 100% answers? I can teach you so you can get 100% answers on your prayers." And he's like, "Okay." And I showed him the verse. We have to ask according to whose will? I'm looking at verse 14 with him. And he says, according to his will. I said, "Good. So what if," I asked him, "what if it's not his will for you to marry that one? It's his will for you to marry that one." And I was just pointing to, you know, a different gal in the room. And he went, "Don't pray. If you're not going to pray for her, then don't pray, because you don't understand what I'm asking." And I said, "Oh, I do." And it became more obvious to me, whose will was he asking for? His. But you know, if anyone could help us pick out the right spouse, who knows what that person will be like 5 years, 10 years from now, 30 years. Does God know the beginning from the end? Does he know our lives? Does he know who will complement us through all that journey? Who will help us through the ups and the downs and grow with us? Or, in the case of some folks, they don't receive this, will grow apart. And I think a lot of people would be spared if they would just check in with our boss and say, "How about your will on who I'm with?" You know, this is probably one of the biggest areas of wrestling in the Christian church today, is that believers trust God for their eternal salvation, but they don't trust him for their spouse. They think their picker is better than his picker. They think they know more than God in this area. Why do we do that? I mean, think that one through. Is that really smart? To put your knowledge above God's? Let me submit to you, you don't do well when you do that. You'd be better off to say, "Not my will, but whose will? Your will." In every area of your life, you want to be blessed, you want to see your prayers answered, start trying this. Just give it a whirl this week. Just say, "God, not my will, but whose will be done? Your will be done." And see if you don't start seeing answers to prayer. And you might see some things just explode in your spiritual journey that you have not experienced before, because maybe you've been pressing to get your will done and you're wondering why it hasn't been working. You know, the people who come to me and they're like, "Yeah, well, you get answers all the time. I never get any answers." I usually can figure out right away who they're praying for. Whose will, I should say, whose will are they praying? Theirs. It is not a spiritually healthy thing. You're better off to submit your will to the one who made you. The one who knows you, the one who knows what you will become, the one who wants to give you what you need for that journey. Maybe you need a little blessing of, you know, to me it's almost like angels come to my door sometimes. Some of you tourists come at the end of your trip and go, "Here, you know, we didn't want to leave it in the condo. They're going to just, you know, the maid will take it, or the housekeeper or whatever, and we want to go to help someone." Okay. What they don't realize is what a blessing it is to us and our walk when we sit there unloading and going, "Look, item one on the list, item two. Lord, you're so good." Now, if you've never experienced what I'm talking about, you maybe need to try this week. When you get ready to pray, let's gussy up your prayer a little. When you get ready to pray, God, I need this thing. Here's my petition. How about I'll give it to you with no strings attached? You answer the way according to your will. Because you could be praying, maybe you're praying for a new car. Or maybe praying a certain old car. God, give me that. I really like that. You know, when I was a kid, it was the, it was made by Volkswagen, but it wasn't a Volkswagen. It was the stretched out little, I just forgot what they call it. Carmen Ghia. You guys know what Carmen Ghia is? The convertible. One of those. Carmen Ghia convertible, Lord. And one of my teachers at school had one. And he had been working and working to get it fixed up. You know, the teachers don't always make that much money. So it was one of those kind of trade with the shop teacher for time to do stuff and get the shop teacher to get some of the students to help fix it up. And I used to, you know, when you're in high school, you're like, ooh, wouldn't it be great to have that car? Then I got to know the teacher, and I found out that that car was a piece of junk. It overheated all the time. They're not water-cooled, the engines. They're air-cooled, and they don't get enough air to cool it, you know, and there's a lot of problems with them. But they don't tell you that on the outside, right? They don't say, written on the outside, this thing's a piece of junk. Lots of problems. Constant overheat, constant breaking down. No, they don't say that. It just looks good on the outside. And sometimes we make all of our decision-making, our understanding, by looking at things, what I call, on the outside. When we have a God who knows all what's under the hood. And he might be going, I really don't think that would work for you. You'd be cursing and kicking it really soon, you know, on its first breakdown, which would be tomorrow. But we don't know what tomorrow will bring, so we're thinking, give it to me now, God. This is what I want. He's going, maybe a Porsche convertible. You know, same company, just upgraded. Found out later, I didn't know that Volkswagen got Porsche later, and they kind of look like they stole some of the design. And yeah, wonder where they got that. Well, God might have something better. But you limited him with your prayer. That man walked away from me going at Bible school, nope, don't bother praying. If I don't get what I want, I don't want you to pray. I thought, how many people have gotten what they want only to find out it really wasn't what they wanted later? They didn't know it, though. See, our will is flawed. And if you can receive that today, God's will for you, is his will good for you? I'm going to end on this note. Is God's will really good for you? Does he know better than you know? Then is it going to really hurt for you to pray for his will? I mean, it's going to hurt you, right? He's going to crush you as soon as you say, your will, not mine. He'll ruin your day. Is that what he's up to? No. But why are you so afraid to pray for his will? Some of you, because you think you know better. You don't. And then you call up us pastors and say, why don't I get my prayer answered? Refer you back to the verse. Whose will are you supposed to ask? His will. Then you know he hears you. Then you know you have the thing you've asked. Try it this week. Just do it for me. Let's give it a test whirl. Anyone willing to try this for a week? You're going to pray for all week. Not my will, but your will be done. Whatever petition it is, whatever thing, just start praying his will. And then come back next week and tell me, how was the answering? Do you think we'll have an increase in answered prayers this week? Yes. Do you think we'll start seeing? I can't tell you how exciting it would be to me if all of you would do this for me. All week long, just ask God's will for whatever thing you're praying for. As you put that petition before the Lord, throw in, don't forget, end. Not my will, but your will be done. According to your will, Lord, answer, here's my petition, need groceries. Don't put conditions. Don't do that like me, you know, I need the money to go buy the groceries. That's a waste of time. I didn't even think that one through. See, God was looking out for the guy who doesn't like to go grocery shopping. He's like, I'm going to spare you. I'll just deliver. Delivered. My groceries were delivered to the door. Talk about saving time. Do you think God might save you some time if you pray like this? God, here's my petition. Your will be done. if you'd all do this for me, I think we will start. We'll come back next week going, you're not going to believe what happened. Some of you are going to be praying for some of your family or your loved ones that are fighting cancers and hurting. And it'd be nice to see some miracles. And some of you just need to remember the key. Here's the key. Ask his will. In whose name? In Jesus' name. And let's see what he'll do. He says he will answer. You ask according to his name. I didn't make this up. He said it. Try it. Let's pray. Father, we ask that this week would be a week of just renewed and increased prayer in our lives with effective prayer, where we would pray, Lord, and see your hand move, to see your will done for us, for those around us, Lord, for those, we pray for those over in Orlando, such a horrific thing. We just ask for comfort for the families that will be mourning, the ones that will be hurting, Lord, the ones, the 50 or plus so that are in the hospital right now. We ask, Lord, that you would bring angels of mercy to their bedsides to help them through this pain and suffering. And that you give believers boldness to come and bring good news to those that need it, that might perish, Lord. We don't want any to be cut off. We want them all to come to know you. We ask, Lord, that you would pour out a move of your spirit there in that community through this. Just make this a stirring to bring people back to you. Give boldness to the Christians there, full of your grace and love for those that are hurting. And as we go, Lord, from this place, we put all our petitions before you. We ask your will be done in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Let's sing a closing song and send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.